In September 1905, a group of mandarins paraded majestically into the Forbidden City. They were there to present themselves to the Emperor Guangxu and the Empress Dowager Cixi. The group had assembled with one solemn purpose: to decide the fate of the system that for over 1,300 years had been the bedrock of the empire's civil administration. Educational reform has been an issue in China for decades, if not centuries. Finally, in the late Qing Dynasty, things began to change. A decision was taken in 1901 as China's failing relations with the rest of the world illustrated the nation's weakness, to change to a modern Western-style schooling system within 10 years. Progress, however, was slow. The attachment of the scholar gentry to the old system had always raised the prospect of serious resistance to any change. They simply had too much invested in the old system and too much to lose. But now, in 1905, the situation could brook no further delay. The Emperor and the Empress Dowager sat in judgment. The imperial examination system is sometimes called the fifth great invention of China, after the compass, gunpowder, paper making, and printing. For centuries, it served to select the men capable of holding the vast empire together and to bond the educated in a common purpose. But now, it had come to be seen more as a straitjacket than a support. The question was, could China survive without it? The meritocratic essence of the imperial examination system meant that it always had been seen as a ladder for social mobility. To qualify at any level was an achievement, and to qualify at the highest levels could bring honor, glory, and riches for generations. By the 19th century, the limitations of the Confucian study system were becoming ever more apparent. In the fall of 1863, leading statesman and general Zheng Guofan received a visitor. Zheng was a gentry scholar who had taken up arms to defend the empire from the Taiping rebels. Now on the brink of victory, he was the most powerful man in the country. His visitor was one Rong Hong, the first Chinese man to be educated in the West.
Rong Hong, 出生在与澳门仅一水之隔的广东香山一个普通家庭。 幼年时，入普鲁士人开设的西所就读，接受西方教育。 18岁时，随外籍教师赴美，日耶鲁大学深造，成为中国第一位留学西洋的留学生。
After his graduation in 1854, Rong Hong returned to China. He returned to a country, much of which was devastated by a war that had killed 20 million people. Rong Hong dreamed of contributing to the rebuilding of the nation. But in 1863, with the Taiping rebels contained, but still dangerous, Zheng Guofan needed access to Western manufacturing technologies to support the government's arsenals. Zheng commissioned Rong to go back abroad and buy the necessary machinery. In fact, Rong Hong had been hoping for Zheng's backing in asking the court to send Chinese students abroad to study Western science and technology. Millions and millions of hours of scholarship have been dedicated to pursuit of perfection within the imperial examination system. For a country whose culture has reigned supreme across East Asia for 2,000 years, this was a huge step.
1960年代，自19世纪40年代，一场以蒸汽机的单身作为标志的华氏代的工业革命在英国兴起。工业革命彻底改变了世界历史的进程。由于产业革命和科技进步带来了生产力的大解放，使得资本主义强势崛起。英国迫切需要抢占海外市场，大量倾销商品，而中国正是理想中的巨大商品市场。
In 1793, the British sent an embassy to China, hoping to establish trade relations. However, the imperial government, under the aged emperor Qianlong, rebuffed them. The emperor told the British, "We possess all things. I see no value on objects strange or ingenious, and have no use for your country's manufactures." In fact, in the late 18th century, there was a huge trade imbalance in China's favor, which the British sought to even up by selling opium grown in India. But when the governor of Canton destroyed British-owned opium stocks in 1839 and then refused to pay compensation, the British sent a fleet to enforce their commercial rights. The brief war left China humiliated and forced to open its ports under the first of a series of unequal treaties. Military defeat came as a profound shock to the Qing. Gradually, there was an awakening to just how far China had fallen behind the rest of the world in science and technology. It was a problem the traditional Confucian education system could only exacerbate. Zeng and Li's petition to the emperor was a recognition that the problem could no longer be ignored. Many scholars had joined China's self-strengthening movement in the 1860s and 70s to achieve economic and military modernization. Those selected had received some traditional Chinese education, but all were eager to imbibe the promised new learning. On August 11, 1872, notwithstanding the scorn of the nation's many chauvinists, the first group of 30 students, all aged 12, boarded ship for San Francisco. The plan was for them to study in the United States for 15 years.
Yang Pai 虽然意识到中国需要向西方学习，但毕竟局限于虚无层面。 在中期西用的框架内，并未动摇传统教育的根据。但无论如何，有种留美计划弥补了科技培养人才的不足，也说明科技趋势的合理性开始受到质疑。In
March 1895, a group of men from Nanhai in Guangdong arrived in the capital for the imperial examination. Among them was Kung Yo Wei. Born in 1858, Kung had long chafed at the limitations of the imperial exam system. In 1888, Kung had gained fame or notoriety for a reformist petition he had submitted to the court. In 1891, he had founded a school run on modern principles in Guangdong. Few of his proposals reached the emperor, killed off quietly by conservative officials, to whom Kung was a dangerous radical. In 1895, he arrived in the capital with his student Liang Qichao, intending them both to sit the metropolitan examination. The chief examiner that year was a royal scholar and academician called Xu Tong. Xu had seen some of Kung's earlier proposals and had called Kung a madman. Xu was determined to fail Kung, come what may. However, since the identities of the examinees were hidden, he couldn't tell which was Kung's paper. Xu told his assistants, if there were any outstanding papers written by candidates from Guangdong, fail them. They found one such outstanding paper and failed it with a mocking quotation from a famous love poem. My tears wet the pearls, I have to return to you. What a shame I'm not available.
据风水意义的是，这万被诬让为是康有为而遭到做了的事卷，其实并非康有为所做，而是他的弟子梁启超的。这样一来，康有为倒偏偏考中了。据说，徐桐当时激怒心肠，关照门卫：如果康有为来访，拒不接待。
Xu would have even been less amused when Kang Youwei celebrated his past by flying a special banner outside his family home. However, as Kang was celebrating, China's ruling class were reeling from yet another military failure, a comprehensive defeat by Japan in the First Sino-Japanese War. Of the 1894-95 war made it seem that the 30 years of effort under the self-strengthening movement had all been in vain. The modern Beiyang fleet had been defeated easily. Even foreign observers were surprised at the failure. The Treaty of Shimonoseki ceded both Taiwan and the Liaodong Peninsula to Japan. It further stipulated that China had to pay Japan 200 million silver tiles in compensation and abandon its influence in Korea. Elder statesman Li Hongjiang, who had long warned of Japanese expansionism, had to be called on once again to try to make the best of the situation. Japan was represented by its prime minister, Ito Hirobumi, a key figure in both Japan's reform and its expansionism. Li was even shot and seriously wounded by a Japanese nationalist during the negotiations.
人们开始反思，甲午一月看似败在军事，实质是败在体制。中国唯有变法才能图强。康有为和弟子梁启超联合各省举人，发动声势浩大的工具上书。他在工具上书请变通科举制度。
Published on June 11th of that same year. On June 23rd, a decree was issued abolishing the eight-legged essay as the examination answer format.
破题、成题、起讲、入手、起鼓、中鼓、后鼓，硕鼓八个部分组成。两鼓之间文字繁简、声调繁介，必须对仗。各鼓各有规定，字数亦有严格限制，但又必须前后连贯，可称为适应八股趋势。毕生钻研八股套说，其他学问不闻不问。
But Guangxu's across-the-board reforms proved too much, too fast for the conservative factions of the government and the Manchu aristocracy. The abolition of sinecures, the proposal for constitutional monarchy, the emphasis on science, technology and commerce all threaten many vested interests. Reactionaries looked to the Empress Dowager Cixi, for so long the power behind the throne, to resist her nephew. On September 21st, 1898, Cixi struck. The emperor was placed in protective detention on Yingtai Island within the grounds of the royal palace. The six main reform leaders were arrested and executed. After her successful coup, the Empress Dowager resumed the regency she began when she had placed her three-year-old nephew on the throne in 1875. She also resumed the old style of imperial examination.
法国费尔有福,
说明晚清教育改革的艰难，更说明改革派和怀柔派之间博弈的激烈。但不管怎么样，科技改革也是大势所趋。
On the morning of August 15th, 1900, Empress Dowager was at her toilette in the Forbidden City when a bullet flew through a window. Then a member of the Imperial household rushed in to warn her that the foreign soldiers were on their way to the palace. Outside the palace walls, all was chaos as troops from the Eight Nation Alliance, who had the day before fought their way into the city to relieve the siege of the foreigners in the legation district, cleared the streets. The Empress decided to flee. The Empress Dowager had discreetly encouraged the anti-foreigner violence of the Boxer movement in North China. Now things had got out of control, and foreign troops arrived to restore order. Some elements of the Manchu aristocracy had supported the Boxers in an attempt to rid the country of foreign influence. In pandering to this populist sentiment, Su Shi had made a massive miscalculation which had left the country's rulers divided. With lawlessness breaking out and foreign troops poised to take control of the capital, Su Shi panicked. She informed the emperor, Wang Shu, that they had to flee. They changed into plain clothes and slipped out of the palace's rear gate. The city's imperial examination compound, the site of so many a scholar's hopes and dreams, was one of the casualties of the fighting. Returned to the city in January 1901, Su Shi finally publicly accepted the need for reform. According to the new decree, reform was to cover the military, law, government, manufacturing, and education.
Qing 母新政可说是内外交困下的不得已之举。八国联军攻入北京后，曾指慈禧是战争祸首，是他招呼义和团向西方宣战。只有改革旧制，推行新政，不得排外，方可免于追究。正因为如此，慈禧才惊魂甫定，发出变法遗志。当然，他也是想通过变法让王朝摆脱困境。
Education was an important part of the reform package. On August 29th, 1901.An edict announced the abolishment of the military examination and the reforming of the civil examination, with the eight-legged essay once again being struck down for the last and final time. The edict also made provision to establish a modern school and college system. To attract students to the new courses, the university charged no tuition fees while offering stipends and bursaries. At the same time, it encouraged the students to take the imperial examination while studying new subjects. However, most students still saw the imperial examination as their top priority, with negligible interest in the new courses offered. The university soon faced going bankrupt.
科技作为国家人才大典，历代王朝军事专款专款专用，而血汤是新生事物，政府并无这项预算。清廷在历次战争中屡败，不得不以各地赔款来求和，有计是马关条约、辛丑条约后，国库亏空，债台高筑，无力在血汤办学上再投入资金。一些地方开始挪用科技经费来办学堂。 已是有人指出，科技不费，心血不行。科技的存在，阻碍了血堂的发展。In
March 1903, several provincial governors together recommended to the court that the imperial examination be gradually scaled down. Pointed out that without abolishing the imperial examination, scholars would continue to focus on outdated and impractical studies.
只注重文章，而当时的中国急需旷世救国之才，不仅需要文科，更需要理科、工科、经济、法律等各领域的人才。因此，学校教育呢，顺应了时代发展的要求，逐年递减科举总额，虽是一个渐进的计划，却是晚清教育改革的重要一步。
While China was trying to reform its educational system, its territory was being fought over by two foreign powers. In 1853, Japan's self-enforced isolation was broken by the guns of Commodore Perry's U.S. warships. Thereafter, Japan vigorously embraced modernization in a process called the Meiji Restoration. It established a constitutional monarchy and set about revamping its industry and its military. Within 50 years, it had become the most formidable power in Asia. The 1904 Russo-Japanese War was proof of Japan's new strength. China was powerless to intervene, as the subsequent treaty saw Russia hand former Chinese territory to Japan and the strengthening of Japanese influence in Korea. Once again, Japan's success, and the first defeat inflicted on a European power by an Asian one, took the rest of the world by surprise. In China, it was interpreted by reformers as the victory of a constitutional monarchy over an autocratic imperial dictatorship.
日俄战争只中国知识阶层认识到了帝制的弊害，连帝国管理层内部也痛彻地感受到，只有立宪才能救中国。那么，作为国家人才战略的科举制度，到底怎么改？是小圈女人的改，还是大刀阔斧的改？当时各种思潮的博弈十分激烈。
1904 metropolitan exams could not be held in the capital because Beijing's examination compound had not been rebuilt after its destruction in the Boxer Rising. Instead, the exams were held in the ancient capital of the Northern Song, Kaifeng, in Henan Province. Changes had been introduced to make the examinations more relevant to China's contemporary needs, testing the examinees' understanding of world affairs and in solving complex practical issues. After the metropolitan exam in Kaifeng, the palace exams were held in the sultry heat of a Beijing July at the Summer Palace. When the chief examiner brought the list of successful candidates, the Empress Dowager was vexed. The first name on the list, the top-scoring candidate, was called Zhu Ruzhen. The name bore a similarity to that of the Emperor's former favorite, Consort Zhen. Zhen had been a modernizer who had encouraged Guang Shu to stand up to the Empress Dowager. She had died in mysterious circumstances as the Allied powers took control of Beijing in August 1900. It was said Cixi was responsible. Furthermore, Zhu Ruzhen was from Guangdong. In Cixi's mind, Guangdong was a nest of traitors, having spawned both reformist leader Geng Youwei and the revolutionary agitator Sun Yat-sen. He discarded Zhu Ruzhen's paper.
是坊间普遍流传的一种说法。实际上，当时确定前十本殿试卷名次的是光绪，而不是慈禧。加上清朝科举禁止，京城的试卷仍然是密封的，就是光绪帝也无法看到作者的姓名和籍贯。只有等到名次确定后才能册封。但坊间传说说明了殿试排名的随意性。
Empress Dowager Cixi could not have known that those 1904 palace examinations were to be the last ones in history. This time, they were asking for nothing less than complete abolition of the system. The imperial examinations were a waste of resources that the nation could no longer afford. The governors got their way. All imperial examinations were to be canceled from the start of the following year, almost 1,300 years after its initiation. The system finally reached the end of the road.
乐趣了。科举的兴废，说明一种好的制度在不同的历史阶段会发生变异。科举制度作为一种工具，关键在于使用者如何使用它，应根据不同时代的要求调整和改造它的不合理部分。晚清科举制度需要改革的主要是考试内容，但由于渐进式的改革难以在短期内取得显著成效，因此王朝迁怒于工具，就像泼脏水的时候把盆里的婴儿也一并倒掉。
After the imperial examination system was abolished, modern schooling took off. In 1905, there were just 8,000 new model schools in the whole of China. A year later, that number had tripled, and by 1909, there were almost 60,000. As a modern educational system was gradually being established in China, a new type of intellectual began to appear. Educational reform in the late Qing Dynasty was intended to cultivate talented men to save the imperial government from collapse. However, with the tide of history running against China's imperial system, it was a case of too little, too late. Revolution led by Dr. Sun Yat-sen spelt the end of China's imperial age. On January 1st, 1912, Sun Yat-sen was installed as interim president of the Republic of China in Nanjing. On February 12th, 1912, an abdication document was signed on behalf of the six-year-old emperor Hu Yi. Qing Dynasty was consigned to history.
知识学堂培养的是具有西方思想意识的新兴知识分子，他们所推崇的西方宪政和清王朝极力维护的封建旧制是格格不入的，所以废科举、新学堂非但没有成为王朝自救的良药，反而是发酵反清力量的温床。王朝恰恰是培育了自己的掘墓人。清朝在辛亥革命中迅速垮台，新兴知识分子的作用不可小觑。
Over its 1300-year history, the imperial examination system had produced a raft of great talents in poetry and politics, philosophy and economics. It was the backbone of China's intellectual culture. System shaped not just China, but influenced many other countries in Asia and the rest of the world. Korea was the first overseas nation to adopt examinations in the 8th century. However, facing the same problems as China, The system was abolished in 1894. Japanese travelers in Qing Dynasty China took much Chinese culture back to their homeland, the imperial examination system included. Vietnam copied the imperial examination system in its entirety, and it was not abolished until 1919, the last country to do so. In the 19th century, Western countries were inspired to adopt their own civil service entry examinations of what they had seen in China. The imperial examination system, for all its controversies, corruptions, and broken dreams, had a profound influence over the history, not just of China, but of world civilization.